Okay, I think it's 2 minutes past 12, and we have a whole bunch of people on the call. So I think we can go ahead and get started. First off, I think I want to thank everyone for joining the call today. Today is a Friday, of course. I know we are all looking forward to the weekend, and we are happy that you decided to spare 1 hour to listen in on this webinar. We hope it will be very instructive. It will be useful for what value you are looking to get from the session. By means of introductions to get started, my name is Sam. I lead the security and analytics practice for Pozitka. For today's session, I'm also joined by my colleague Prem. He is one of our Splunk consultants. And I, as you already know, of course, the key intention of today's session is to talk a little bit about cloud security. That is the hot topic at the moment now. Security is big, cloud security is even bigger with the advent of so many IaaS, SaaS services. So that is what we are going to be focusing on for the next 55 minutes or so. In case you might have any questions, please feel free to type it in the message box, and we will be happy to answer all your queries. So without further ado, let me get started. I hope my screen is visible. Tilak, are you able to see my screen?
Cannot see a screen, Sam.
Sorry, Morgan, you said you can or you cannot?
Cannot see a screen, Sam.
Yeah, we cannot see.
Not visible.
Okay. That is screen. Let me share again. Is it visible now?
Yeah.
Yep. Yes, sir.
Great. Thank you, Tilak. Thank you, Morgan. So I think as part of the registration, everyone would have seen the agenda, I'm certain. So we want to talk a little bit about why cloud security is important. Now, the fact, of course, that you have signed up shows that you know cloud security is important. So I won't be spending too much time there. We'll talk a little bit about the need for having a multi-pronged approach to cloud security. We'll talk a little bit about what is the framework you need to think about when talking about SIEM for cloud security monitoring. Then there's a small case study to drive home, I guess, what you should be thinking about when you are looking at security monitoring on the cloud. And we'll follow that up with a live demo where my colleague Prem will show you the live view of the case study I would have explained. So we are thinking about 20 minutes or so for the initial context setting exercise, and then another 25-30 minutes for the demo. And then, of course, we'll have the question and answer session in between. So why is cloud security important? I think everyone knows cloud security is important, no doubt. I think the key takeaway from this slide essentially is that there are certain reasons why it's more prominent compared to your on-premise or data center monitoring. Data centers on-prem, you still have breaches, you still have a lot of issues, you still need to protect yourself, but at this point it's a fairly well-known quantity. Cloud security, on the other hand, it's still evolving. Some of the things I think that get exacerbated in the cloud environment as compared to your traditional on-premise, first is the fact that account hijacking has more severe repercussions. If you have an account on AWS, if you have an account on Azure, if someone manages to get access to your admin account on AWS, Azure, GCP, Alibaba, whatever it is, that person immediately has access to a whole host of resources. In the case of on-prem, it's not as easy. You get access to a particular server, you get access to a particular network device, and then again, you need to spread out and propagate. But here, the impact of one account, even one account getting breached, can be pretty significant. The other thing, of course, is that the cloud is something that's democratizing IT to a large extent, which is a good thing. So developers, business teams, shared services, they can all access the cloud. Along with that, the problem that comes up is that you have things like shadow IT creeping up. Someone might fire up some free instances, some virtual machine. They might fire up some services that they are looking to use, some Lambda function. And they might not always be thinking about security. And to a consolidated, centralized IT team, it's always very difficult to keep track of what's going on. And this becomes a nightmare in the cloud context, because there can be so much going on. So shadow IT in particular becomes a big problem. Insecure APIs and API calls. So the entire cloud, of course, it is open to everyone. And most of your communication is going to happen through APIs. So you have so many endpoints, and there's a very high chance of something being misconfigured, either accidentally or intentionally, and then someone misusing that. So you have so many API calls being made inside the organization, outside the organization, by automation tools, by products. And then it becomes very important to see if there's any pattern to the calls. Is there anything that's abnormal that's happening? Is there anyone who could have come in through a misconfigured API and who's doing damage to your system? And I think the biggest single thing, and of course, this is something that most people will already be aware of. So I think the fact that you have so much data stored on the cloud, be it S3 buckets, a lot of the breaches that you would heard about would be about some organization where critical and confidential information was left in a S3 bucket on AWS, and then it was accidentally made public. So people were able to access it from outside the organization. It got leaked. So again, it's a very simple mistake to make, but that can have very dramatic repercussions for the organization. I think the last part that also comes in is from a security operations standpoint. If you are a security analyst, if you're working on traditional on-prem security, typically there's a very well-defined structure. So you have your firewalls, you have your IPS IDS, you'll have your SIEM. So everything is in the control of the security team. So they drive the security regimen on the on-prem environment. On the cloud side, on the other hand, typically you'll have an admin team. So you'll have a cloud admin team, which is taking care of the cloud. And typically in many organizations, they want to do things fast. They have the capability and expertise, but they are not always thinking about security first. So the security team tends to be a little blind in a lot of scenarios as to what's happening on the cloud. It's difficult to get access. It's always an uphill task. So these are some of the risks or some of the, I guess, drivers that exacerbate, like I said earlier, the situation around cloud security in general. And at the bottom also, you'll notice there's a small blurb here. So Gartner has already predicted that going into the next few years, we will see that a lot of cloud security failures will be essentially due to misconfigurations. And they are saying that actually up to 90% of organizations will end up accidentally or by someone breaching it, having the data exposed to the public in general. So that's a little bit about the cloud context. In terms of cloud attacks, you'll see some, I won't go in detail into these, but you'll see some really big names here. So if you're it's not as if misconfigurations cannot happen in large organizations. These are multi-billion dollar organizations that are investing a lot in security teams. They are very conversant in cloud. They are leaders in cloud. You've got Facebook here, for example. Instagram, AutoClerk, Accenture, Verizon, all these are large organizations with big budgets, and they still got breached. So security is a big problem, not just for cloud security is a big problem, not just for small organizations, but also for large organizations. So I think that was a little bit of context about why cloud security is important. Now, in terms of security monitoring itself, and I'm assuming, again, a lot of people on this call, you might have come across a lot of names being thrown around right now. So one example is, for example, if there are a lot of platform native solutions, right? AWS has something called GuardDuty, which is going to monitor AWS resources. Microsoft Azure similarly has something called Security Center. GCP has its own flavor called Command Center, right? So they all do their own things in terms of monitoring the environment. I think a small poll has also been opened up. So if you can take some time to answer that also, that will be very useful. Give me one moment. Yeah. Then you also have the cloud access security broker. So again, that comes into play. This is actually more focused on SaaS applications though, whereas the platform native solutions are more focused on infrastructure as a service on AWS, Azure, GCP. But again, CASB is a cloud monitoring solution. It's going to protect your data. It's going to manage your users. So that's something you're going to see in many cases. There's something called cloud security posture management. This is again tied to your infra as a service. So you might use it for your AWS, GCP, your Azure environment. And this is more for looking at security misconfigurations. So you have all of these things going around. And at the end of it, you also have the SIEM coming in, which has typically been the bread and butter for security analysts so far. So the SIEM is the security analytics platform. And then it does security analytics through the logs, through the events that it sees happening in the environment. And I think we are seeing the results of the poll also right now. Looks like we are saying some people are monitoring to SIEM. Many people are relying on platform native tools. Some are also using CASB and CSPM. Okay, that's excellent. So I think this is a question that we have also been asked a lot and that we have been thinking about a lot as well. So if you have platform native tools, if you have CASB, if you have CSPM, do you actually need something like a security analytics solution to monitor your environment? The answer to that, of course, is yes. Which is the reason we are having that discussion today about why do you need it. And I will illustrate that with a simple example. Now, suppose you take Pozitka as an example. So our domain is pozitka.com. Now, we have our own AWS environment. We have our own Azure environment, our own GCP environment. So most of the administrators or the users who log on are from pozitka.com. Now, at the same time, we also have other service providers who log into our environment for various reasons. Some will do assessment of our services. Some might be vendors we are working with. So there are different vendors logging in, different service providers logging in from different domains. Now, one of the things that we need to do is that we need to keep track of who is logging in, because anyone outside of pozitka.com, that's a potential risk to us. So when you look at cloud security monitoring, one part of your monitoring should be ideally you look for logins that are outside of your domain. And at the same time, what you're going to find out is you're going to say that, okay, maybe xyz.com is okay. And then this particular person, Wang Zhao, is okay. So if he logs in, I'm not worried. And then you say that, okay, Alexander is also someone I know, abc.com is fine. But then you see that there's someone called abc.in, and you think that, okay, I never asked anyone from abc.in or never gave them access to log in, so why are they logged on? So essentially your security team now at this point needs to have some kind of a whitelist or a blacklist, a blacklisting functionality, which says that these are the people I'm allowing access to in terms of my cloud infrastructure. And if anyone outside of this comes in, I need to be alerted. I need to see whether I need to do something with them. Either they're a valid user, but I was not aware of it. So I find out and add them to the whitelist. Otherwise, if they're not authorized, how did they manage to log in? So that's one part of it. The second part of it again becomes, even if they log in, most times if it's an external party, you would give them read-only access. So there are certain sets of access you would want to give them. So again, now Wang Zhao might have, say, access to a certain set of rules, and those are the only things he should be doing. Alexander might have only a particular set of particular set of activities he's supposed to be performing. So again, I need to be able to track that, so that in case I see a deviation even in Wang Zhao or Alexander's behavior and they're doing something they shouldn't, then I get alerted about that. So those kinds of things, for example, are where the SIEM becomes very powerful, because it is meant for exactly scenarios like that. Your cloud native solutions like Azure Security Center or AWS GuardDuty are not going to be able to get down to this level of refinement, because they are meant for alerting. This is actually monitoring. Same thing for CASB or CSPM. They aren't actually meant for these kinds of activities. Here, you're not really saying that there is a problem. You are saying that you are monitoring, and there is a possibility that you are seeing something anomalous and you need to investigate it. So this is something that has to be refined, evolved on an ongoing basis. And as a security analyst, you need to have a high degree of control. Otherwise, you are going to get flooded with what you call false positives. So unless you are able to do this blacklisting and whitelisting, every time Bangzhou logs in, is going to say, hey, someone from another domain is logging in, so do something about it, which isn't the case because you know he's someone you're okay to work with. So that's an example of why something like a SIEM, a security analytics solution, would be very relevant in the case of cloud security monitoring. If I look at a couple of, I guess, high level bullet points also, you always have a SIEM, so you are going to have it to monitor your on-prem, so might as well use it to monitor your cloud environment. What it brings to the table is that it's going to be platform agnostic. You're not tied to a single cloud, and you're going to have multi-cloud monitoring capabilities. You bring in all your alerts. So if you have anything coming in, you know, coming in from your CASB, from CSPM, from Guard Duty, from Sentinel, whatever it is, you can consolidate everything in one place, and then you can sift the chaff from the wheat, the grain from the chaff. You have a lot of customized dashboards you can get. You can do a lot of trending, and it is highly customizable. In terms of the framework that you would want to look at from a threat hunting or from an investigation perspective, typically you'd want to go through four stages. You'd want to think about what data you are working with. You'd want to figure out, okay, how do I do the detection based on the data I'm pulling in? When the detection is done, how do I investigate to see if it's really an issue or not? And then, of course, how do I have a tool that helps me to manage my investigation and make sure that I keep track of all of it? So the first part of it that I spoke about was data sources. So here, for example, I've listed down some of the key data sources you'd work with across AWS, Azure, and GCP. And I think, Tilak, there's also poll we had about whether, yeah. So at the same time, there's a small poll that's going around, if you wouldn't mind answering that. So typically what you would want to do, for example, is one is the audit logs, right? So the audit logs for AWS, Azure, and GCP, they're slightly named differently, but the intention is the same. Then you'll have your security service. So for AWS, it's Guard Duty. For Azure, it's Security Center. For GCP, it's Command Center. Then you'll have your network flow logs. So you'll have VPC flow, NSG flow, VPC flow logs again in GCP. And then whatever is tied to your storage. So who's accessing your storage? What are they doing? In the case of Azure, you also have your AD logs. So these are the bare minimum in terms of what you need to monitor to try and get some sense of what's happening in your environment. And this, again, I think interesting insight, if you can see the results of the poll. So I think more than 50% are saying that they are in a multi-cloud environment, which makes sense, with 40% being on single cloud. I'm assuming that that might also change since organizations are adopting a multi-cloud strategy. With that, I think the second part of it is the detection. So I have the data in now, how do I do the detections? So again, I think you have a lot of services that you'll see on the cloud. Everything is in the form of service. You'll have your storage service, compute service, IAM service. You'll have something for Redis cache. You'll have your key management service. You'll have your database service. There are a whole bunch of services. So for each of those services, you need to define certain detection rules. So for example, if it's storage, are you checking for public access enabled? If it's compute, are you looking for provisioning from unusual region? If it's IAM, are you looking for a critical user who's actually logging in without the multi-factor authentication? And then cutting across platforms, are you seeing, is someone disabling cloud audit logs? Is someone disabling alerts from, are you generating alerts from the native services? So I think the detection part of it is important because as a human, you can't manually keep looking at a lot of dashboards. You need to have a lot of detection rules. That's very important. In terms of investigation and response, my colleague Prem will go into this in a lot of detail, so I won't spend too much time here. Of course, you need to have certain investigation dashboards that let you figure out what happened, and Prem will walk you through that. Once that is done, then you need to be able to manage the lifecycle of the investigation, so some kind of a workflow management system. Prem's again going to walk you through that as part of the demo. I think the last section I had was a small case study, which again, Prem will carry carry through and make it a little more real. What we are seeing here now is, for example, the first step that an intruder or a malicious actor would do is he try to get access to your environment, right? And that's essentially through the account getting compromised. Now, how will he do that? He might use brute force. He might use something like phishing attacks to get passwords. He might use a drive-by, whatever it is. So he's going to use a lot of methods. But how do you detect that that event has happened? So something like improbable geolocation. So normally all your users log in from India or Singapore. You suddenly see a login from Ukraine or Russia or China. So that's something that's an anomaly. You see that there's a first-time console login. So maybe worth looking at who that is. You might see multiple failed logins. User logged in from unusual country. You can have whitelist, blacklist around that. But again, there's a whole bunch of detections to find out if the account has been compromised or not. The next thing that will happen is once an account has been compromised, your attacker is most likely going to assume that the password is going to be reset and then he's going to be shut out of the system. So one of the things he would like to do is he would like to continue having access to the services or to your environment by creating an account or a service ID. So again, if you see that there's anything fishy in terms of new users being created, that's something you need to monitor for. And I think the last part of it becomes the impact. So assuming that attacker has managed to come in, he's managed to stay in the system, what's he going to do next? One of the possible things that can happen, of course, is cryptojacking. So cryptojacking doesn't have any immediate financial impact per se on the organization. So you might not even know about it. If it's a data breach, it's more important. In the case of cryptojacking, it's going to drag up your cost in the long term. So what might happen is that you'll see that once the attacker has gained access to your environment, he might start creating some really high-end machines. And then that starts adding to your cost in the long term. So he's going to use all those machines for crypto mining so that the benefits of that get funneled to him. While on your side, you essentially have to bear the cost of all these additional machines that are getting generated. So again, to keep track of things like that, you'll have to do things like anomalous behavior in how the VMs are being created. The VM configuration itself, is this something abnormal that you don't see? If you pick that up, then there's a possibility that you have been essentially hacked, and then someone's using your infrastructure for their own purposes. So I think with this, I wanted to set the stage, set the context for the actual demo. As I said, my colleague Prem will take over from here, and he'll walk us through this case study in more detail. But before that, in case anyone has any questions, I would be happy to answer that. Any questions from anyone, or should we move on to the next section? I don't think there are any questions at the moment. So Prem, over to you.
Yeah, thank you, Sam. Let me know if you can see my screen, everyone.
Yep, thanks, Prem. Visible now.
Okay, so first of all, I wish you a very happy new year. On that note, without any further delay, let me start with the live demo. So I will try to explain the use case which Sam has walked you through in the PPT. So it's a crypto mining use case. So let me just try to explain that here. As a SOC analyst, I come in on a Friday morning and hoping that there will be no much instance to work on. But if I see the IR dashboard here, so looks like there are more incidents and definitely not a good way to start my day. So I'm just looking here and so this one, right? Detect critical role assignment for a newly created user, or even we can take something like a geographically improbable access detected. Okay. So this is the incident that I've got. If I expand it, I can see that the user Sendhil V has logged in from multiple locations in a very short span of time. So he has logged in from India, and the immediate next login was from Albania. And the time difference is not that huge, right? So, okay, so this is the incident that I got. So what do I do now? So let me check if the user has any other relevant or any other incidents in the day. So these are the incidents that attacked the user. I can see that improbable access detector, that is one incident. And I see that the user is creating some, doing some critical role assignment process. And okay, so these are some recurring alerts for the user. Okay, so I've got this incident, and what do I do now? I'll just use the investigation dashboard. So let's open the threat hunting investigation dashboard, and let's see what the user is doing for a while. And as you can see here, the incident, the event time was around December 30th. So you can see here, so the December 30th was the time the activity happened. So let me open here, and let me select the time period, 30th December. And yeah, okay. So users with multiple locations, user logins with multiple locations. I can see that the user is primarily from India. I mean, he could be a admin guy, so he's primarily from India. And immediately he's logged in Albania. So with a different IP. So you can see that there are two source IPs in India, and there is different altogether IP in Albania. And these are the three IPs associated with the user. So these are the three IPs, and let me check if there are any associated incident with the user. Okay, let me just reload it. Let me just reload for a moment. So the idea here is to how effectively one can do the investigation using Splunk for cloud monitoring. And okay, that's a bit strange. Okay, so let me check if there are any incidents associated with the user. Okay. Okay, I think it's selected as today. So yeah, give me a minute. So yeah, there you go. So these are the incidents that are triggered as a recurring alerts, as you can see. So in a span of every 15 or 20 minutes, we are just checking for the last 7 day or 8 day activity. So improbable access detected and critical role assignment. And there is also this nice sequence analyzer where you can actually see in what sequence the incidents have been triggered for that specific user. So as you can see the sequence here, so first the user is logging in from multiple locations, which is like geographically improbable access because of the short span of duration and the distance of the locations he logging in. And next is doing some critical role assignment. Okay, so for a newly created user. So this has happened in the span of, let's say 6 minutes, right? So, okay, so this is what I see, and looks like a fishy incident. All signs of account compromise. So if I want more details about this, right, I just click more details here. And we just saw the incident. How about the incident details? So these are the specific details of that incident. So on December 30, Senthil is the user, was logging in from multiple locations, that is India and Albania, using multiple IPs. And so the distance, so this is the distance, that's why the alert has been triggered from the recent logging location. And the next logging location was at 5,500 kilometers. And the next alert that is associated for the user is the critical role assignment. So basically, Senthil, since he logged in Albania, the next activity he performed was at 11:37. He logged in Albania around 11:33. At 11:37, he's doing a critical role assignment, right? And the user who is associated with this activity is Little Boy. So Little Boy is the newly created user, and Posetka admin is the critical role assignment that the user is doing. And again, the username sounds very strange. So let's see what this user has to tell us. So instead of Senthil, just search for Little, click on it, the same time range. Again, I can see multiple locations, multiple IPs, and I'm just checking if there is any associated incidents for the user. So, okay, so what this user is doing is that looks like he's doing some cloud provisioning activity, right, in unusual region. So in Splunk, we can easily do whitelisting and blacklisting. Say, for example, we have in the back end of this rule, right? So we have a set of regions that are whitelisted. So if the regions are not part of the whitelist, then you get this alert, something called as unusual region. So let's say...
Prem, I think Tiago's just mentioning there's no data. It shows only loading for him. I think... your screen seems to be stuck for me as well. Do you want to stop sharing and reshare again?
Sure, Sam. Yeah. How about now, Sam?
Yes. Tiago, is that okay? Are you able to see now? Okay, so now it's fine, it looks like. Okay. Thank you.
Yeah. So we were seeing about this user, Little Boy, and when I just search the name Little Boy, it shows that it has multiple logins across multiple locations, and also it has multiple IP associations, and the incidents, right, related to this new user, which has a critical role assigned. I can see that he is creating some... instances, like he's doing some cloud provisioning activities in a very frequent manner. So again, looks like a sign of, so that's the use case Sam explained, right? Once the account gets compromised and he creates or assigns a user a very critical role, and then the newly created user with a privileged role does some cloud provisioning activity in unusual region. So let's see for more details. So this is the sequence. It's been recently the incident triggered for the user. So if I just look for more details, right? Okay. So as you can see here, so this is the sequence. So 11:33, Senthil has logged in from Albania using a different IP, and then he created a new user with a privileged role at 11:37, and then immediately after the creation at 11:45, at 11:41, the user Little Boy, he is doing some cloud provisioning activity. So this is the sequence we can see here. And so this is the instance ID that is created, and the country which the server is provisioned is Albania, and AWS region is Northeast 2, which is not a whitelisted one. So the usual whitelisted category is the AP South. So that's why the incident has been triggered. And okay, so this is the sequence. And if you want to investigate further, let's say as a SOC analyst, I would like to see the raw events as well, right? I can easily do that. So I just choose the date the date of the incident. Go here, apply. Instead of star, I just give, let's say I want to search this IP. Because if you see this IP, right, it's common across all three incidents. So this is the newly logged in location IP. And from that location, it's creating a new user. And again, with the same source, we are seeing this activity. So I want to search this IP for any raw events that I'm interested. I'll just put a simple condition, let's say little, because I want to see the activities for that user and run instances. So this is the event name, right? I want to narrow down the event. So here is the culprit, like only two events, as you can see here. So we have narrowed down to that exact event in a matter of minutes. So this is the exact event that happened. And yeah, as you can see, it's very, very easy to do the investigation. And whatever that you see as dashboards here, as a hunting or more details, everything is highly customizable as per the requirements. So this is just a simple threat hunting investigation flow that I wanted to let you all know. So any questions on this so far? Because like in the next few minutes, I'll be showing other features that will be useful for a SOC analyst. So yeah, if you have any questions, please let me know. And okay, so no questions, right? So okay, in that case, we can proceed further. Right, so okay. So as a SOC analyst, right, it will be very helpful for me if I have a overall security posture of what's happening in my environment, cloud infrastructure. And it will be very useful for a SOC analyst if I have a integrated response framework, like incident response framework. I need not use an external tool or an external application, right? So if it is integrated into the system or SIEM that I'm using, it will be very useful for me. And especially in the aspect of multi-cloud monitoring, if I have certain supporting dashboards across multi-clouds like Azure or AWS or GCP, because like some of the commonly used services are compute, IAM, storage, and network. So what if I have a very good overview dashboards on each of these services? And what if I have a security analytics dashboard, which can show me the list of common security metrics in the service? And it'd be more awesome if I have a dashboard that is exclusively for the use cases that have been configured. So let's say, for example, a critical instance shutdown, or let's say the example that we saw just now, a critical role assignment. So if I have a dashboard for more further analysis or trend analysis, it will be more useful for me. So that's what this solution has. And also for easier investigations, right? By IP or user or the threat hunting investigation that we saw just now, it'll be very helpful if I have some supporting dashboards or supporting tools to let me do the investigation easier. And Sam was speaking about the current security posture management. And let's say if I have an open source tool called CrowdSuit, and it's very, very easy to integrate that with Splunk. And you can easily scan the current security posture and show it as a dashboard. So yeah, so these are some of the features. Let me explain it. And yeah, and also for a SOC analyst, it would be very, very valuable if we have a lot of use cases, especially in the multi-cloud aspect. Like if I have more use cases to or more detection rules. The more the detection rules, the more easy to do monitoring and the more aspect we'll cover. So say AWS, there are certain rules that have been configured. And for example, yeah. Say for example, this one, provisioned AWS EC2 instances with metadata service version. So this is the Capital One example which Sam had shown earlier. So these are some of the rules that we can configure very easily. which can be helpful to prevent any such attack. And let's say Azure. So, and we do have alerts, let's say configured across multiple services. It's very easy to develop these use cases or rules or alerts across different services, let's say IAM, network, storage. So by platform and by service, these can be easily configured to help a SOC analyst. So yeah, this is the alerts or the use cases page. So let's jump to the security posture. So yeah, so this is the security posture page. And this gives a high level view of what's happening in my multi-cloud environment. So what is my under Azure, what is my total Azure incidents, and across services, how the incidents looks like, right? And by severity, how much of the alerts are high, medium, low, and what is the trend, alerts over trend. So what are the top alerts that have been triggered for the selected time range? So these are some of the nice to have dashboards, especially for the management. If you have to report something as a SOC manager or a SOC lead, it could be very helpful. We can just extract this as a report and send it across in a very quick time. And so as Sam was telling, right, you can also integrate the platform native alerts into a single solution. So let's say you are using multi-cloud, Azure, AWS, and GCP. There are platform native solutions like Azure Security Center, GCP Command Center, and also the AWS GuardDuty. So as a SOC analyst, it's very difficult to monitor all of this in different places. So if you just integrate everything into a single platform like Splunk, it becomes more powerful and more easier for the analyst to do the correlation and to do the monitoring. So that's another good thing about Splunk that we can do. So yeah, so this is the platform native section. As you can see, total Azure Security Center alerts, how much of it, it's triggered, and what is the severity, medium, low, and what are the top AAC alerts. So this is the Azure view, and similarly, we can have the AWS also. So the same view across different services, how many alerts, and also instead of the Security Center, we'll be having the GuardDuty alerts here. So yeah, that's the security posture dashboard. And yeah. So next up is the incident posture. So as I was telling, you may not use a separate tool or application to do the incident management. So inside the same solution, inside the same SIEM, you can have this integrated IR framework where you can easily triage the incidents, manage the incidents, and do the investigation and response in a single solution in a single place. So this is how it looks like. It gives you an overall summary of how the incidents looks like in a specific time range, and what is the low, medium, high, critical, what is the severity of these alerts, right? And as you can see here, you can easily filter down the incidents by either username or IP or whatever that you want. And if you just expand this alert, you can see the alert details as well. So what is the day which the incident has happened, and what are the other relevant details for that alert. So yeah. And you can easily click this. Let's say I want to do more investigation and I want to open it and view search, right? You can easily do that. So just click the search icon and it will open the raw search query along with the results. So if you want to do some manipulation that you want to do, I can easily do it here. It's very much customizable, and you can use this SPL query to do that. And so as I was telling, the incident triaging part, so that is also taken care of by this framework. So you can change the urgency, you can assign a new owner, you can add some comment as a SOC analyst, you can update the progress of the incidents. So everything will be tracked under the history column. So that's another feature. And right now it is unassigned. So as I was telling, you can easily assign it here. So right now it's assigned to admin. So yeah, and the good thing about is like we can even integrate the use cases with threat intelligence feeds. So right now we are getting feeds from our own MISP server that we have hosted. So the threat feed is coming from MISP, and we are also doing the threat match. So if there is a match, it will get displayed over here. So what is a threat intel match? What is a threat collection? And what is a threat collection key? So in that way, we are also focusing on the threat intelligence part of it. So that's the incident posture page.
There's also a question from Tejas. I think that's an interesting question, Prem. So I think Tejas is asking, when you integrate these cloud platforms, how did you normalize the data using existing add-on, or did you tag the logs from scratch? So I think that's a good question. Sounds like Tejas has already worked on Splunk because it's a very specific question. Do you want to answer that very quickly before you move on?
Yeah, sure, Sam. So Tejas, thanks for the question. So in terms of Azure, AWS, and GCP, right, there are existing add-ons from Splunk that you can do the data integration very easily. So basically, it's based on REST API. So you will have to configure the REST API from the AWS Azure. All you need to do is the REST API configuration. You have to configure the account, and you have to configure the storage buckets. So it's very easy to do the integration. And once the data comes in, the Splunk add-on by itself, it can do normalization as well. And yeah, so that's how it is like. It's very easy to do the data integration and also the data normalization part when it comes to Azure, AWS, and GCP, since we have the existing add-ons. Okay. Right. So let me quickly cover the next set of things that I wanted to show. Yeah, as I was telling, there are a lot of supporting dashboards, as you can see here. So we were seeing a use case on the AWS platform, right? The threat hunting use case. So let me just show one of the dashboards, supporting dashboards, how it looks like. So under Azure, we have a lot of services like compute, IAM, storage, and network. These four are the key services. And under each service, we have this common template. So compute overview, compute security analytics. And as you said, it's completely customizable. So this is the IAM overview dashboard, how it looks like. So under user sign-in, we have, as a SOC analyst, it's very helpful to have a segregated view. Let's say a statistics view. If I get a statistics of how many logins are happening over a period of time, and how many of them are successful, failed. So all it helps for my further investigation to understand the environment better, to do the trend analysis. These are supplementary information a SOC analyst can use. And as you can see here, there are 260 failed and sign-ins, and how many IPs are involved in that. So who are the top users who are doing the sign-in operation, and what are the top IPs that are involved, and what are the top apps that are involved, let's say Azure portal or Incom, Azure website, browsers, countries, locations. So we can easily get the statistic view. And also to specifically focus on the failure, because as a SOC analyst or investigation purpose, so we focus mainly on the failures, right? So that's why this view will be helpful. So who are the top users with failed sign-ins? Ashok, Sam, and Senthil, and how the failed sign-ins looks over a period of time for the different users. As you can see, there's a peak 40 failed sign-ins at a specific point of time. And what are the different IPs that are associated with the failed sign-ins, and how it looks like over a period of time. And what are the reasons for the failures? Because there could be several reasons for a login failure, and what are the top reasons? So for example, invalid username or password, that's one reason, and the user did not pass the MFA challenge. So usually there is a multi-factor authentication, right? So the user did not pass the MFA challenge. And how the regions looks over a period of time. So, and from which locations the failed logins are occurring.
So yeah. Prem, a quick time check also. I think we have about 8 minutes left. So maybe we should try to wind up in the next 1 or 2 minutes so that we have some time for questions and then we can wind up.
Sure, sir. Yeah. Okay, so that's the dashboard part of it. And as he was telling, there are other investigation dashboards, let's say user investigation. And in this user investigation dashboards, you can do investigations across multi-clouds because it's a multi-cloud environment and there's a solution for multi-cloud monitoring, right? So if you just search for a user, it will show you, from which cloud the user is logging in, from AWS, Azure is doing multi-cloud activities, what are the operations he's doing, and what IPs are associated for each of the cloud, AWS and Azure. So yeah, that's about it. And we do have some supporting dashboards for security analytics and use case analytics, as I was telling you. So yeah. So this gives me a very helpful view to do the trend analysis for a specific use case, critical role assignment, how many of them have been assigned. So this another supporting dashboards. And I just wanted to show you one more thing. So this is the CSPM or the Scout Suite report that I was talking about. So all you are doing is the simple scan of a current cloud environment. And you can easily get the current posture of your cloud environment in the same solution. So it's easily customizable right now. You can see for AWS and Azure. Let's say I just click for EC2 summaries. It easily shows the warnings, like a critical warning or danger. So let's say EBS volume not encrypted. As per the best practice, it has to be encrypted. So just comparing against frameworks like CIS benchmarks and throwing you the results. So it becomes very helpful for a SOC analyst, and you can let the DevOps team know, they can make the changes. Again, you can scan for the current posture to check whether it's compliant or not. Yeah, so those are the some of the features that I wanted to let you know. We also have certain features like lookup editor. For example, the whitelist and blacklist, we can easily do the lookups, let's say the domains, right? So let's say a login from other domains. So these are the domains for our company. So posetcar.com and pfsi.com. So these are the two known domains for a company. And if there is activity from any other domains, that will get reflected in the use case. So these are some of the things that I wanted to show you today. Please let us know for any questions. Yeah.
Okay. Thank you, Prem, for that. I think we have about 4 more minutes left. So if anyone has any questions, please do let us know. In the meantime, I'll also share this slide. You might have questions about what should we do next. We also have our own demo server. So in case you would like to get access to what Prem just demonstrated, please feel free to reach out. Email ID is demo_request@posetcar.com. In case you have any other queries, you want to explore more about what we do or what are the solutions we have or about CSM in general, feel free to mail us at susan@posetcar.com. Also, thank you so much for spending your time today. As I said, it's a Friday and appreciate you spending the time with us in terms of going through the discussion. Let's see if there are any questions as well that are coming up. Prem, do you want to take any of those?
Yes. I think I see a question from Alex. So the question is, okay, so will this help to monitor my on-prem data center also? Okay. So Splunk has a platform itself, right? It's a log aggregation tool. So whatever that you've seen so far in this demo, it's specifically for cloud environment. But as a Splunk log aggregation tool, it can ingest any sorts of machine data. So it can be your server data, it can be your application server data, anything. So it can ingest, and a customizable solution can be done. And also Splunk comes up with the out-of-the-box solutions for your infra monitoring, for example, Windows monitoring or Linux monitoring. Splunk has a lot of out-of-the-box solutions that you can easily plug and play. So yeah.
Yeah, I think the data integration, there's a question around data integration process, Prem.
Yeah, I think I've answered that earlier. So yeah. How difficult is a data integration process? Yeah, as I said before, there are few add-ons which comes out of the box from Splunk for especially this cloud, right? AWS, Azure, and GCP. Microsoft Cloud Services add-on. We have Splunk add-on for AWS. We have Splunk add-on for GCP. That is very, very easy to integrate, as it all follows a common integration mechanism. Like AWS, you just have to integrate it via REST API input. So it's very easy to do the process.
Good. I think we're also at the top of the hour now, Prem, and I think I don't see any more questions at the moment. So right. So again, I think thank you everyone for joining us today. We hope you found the session informative. In case you still have any questions, of course, do feel free to reach out to us, and have a great weekend. Thank you, everyone. Thanks, Prem.
Thank you. Thank you, everyone, for your time. Have a great weekend. Yeah.
Very special thanks to participants. Hope this session was very useful to you.